service starts, just a few announcements. That they are in the pupils. But with the commissioning of our new minister coming in November, we'd like to form a choir for that night. So any of you that would love to sing with us, the 8 o'clock service people see me, and the 10 o'clock people, choir, who's going to help us with the music. We had the organist to play for us today, playing on the night as well, so we'll have some beautiful music. Also, Anglican is after training day. Catch hold of me for that one. For new trainees or people who have done the training before, there's no physical work in this, but it's a lot of sitting around and organising. But the last few months have gone, I spent 3 days in the recovery centre handing out clothes and beds, so that's the sort of thing we do. Ladies' night out coming up on 28th of September. If you're in there, your Bush Church opening, boxes are opening now. Also, we've got a special night coming up on the 30th of September at 7 p.m. A worship night that will be held down in the hall, and that will be a wonderful night to go to. And we're going to take this privilege to welcome God back. Been away, injured, and they haven't been able to get to the church, so just so wonderful to see you back. And I noticed up the back our American friends back as well. So, yay! So you can't speak through me. Anyway, so okay, so welcome to worship.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. Jesus said, this is the great and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ. With the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And prayer for today is on the second page in your PC. And let's pray together. O God, from whom light rises in darkness for those who seek you, grant us in all our doubts and uncertainties the grace to ask what you would have us do, that in your light we may see light, and in your narrow path may not stumble. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of your Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the ministry of the word.
Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
nations have invaded your inheritance.
They have defiled your holy temple. They have reduced Jerusalem to rubble.
They have left the dead bodies of your servants as food for the birds of the sky, the flesh of your own people for the animals of the wild.
They have pulled down the blood of the water all around Jerusalem, and there is no one to bury their dead.
We are objects of contempt to our neighbours, of scorn and derision to those around us.
How long, Lord, will you be angry forever? How long will your jealousy burn like fire?
Pour out your wrath on the nations that do not acknowledge you, on the kingdoms that do not call on your name.
For they have devoured Jacob, and their salvation is found
in. Do not hold against us the sins of past generations.
May your mercy come quickly to meet us, for we are now in our flesh already. Help us, God, our Savior, for the glory of your name.
The second reading comes from the book of Timothy, the first letter of Paul to Timothy. The first letter of Paul to Timothy, chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. It's about instruction on worship. I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings, all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Saviour, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man, Jesus Christ, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. This has now been witnessed to at the proper time, and for this purpose I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I am telling the truth, I am not lying, and a true and faithful teacher to the Gentiles. Therefore, I want the men everywhere to pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or disputing. I also want the women to dress modestly, with decency and propriety, adorning themselves not with elaborate hairstyles, or gold or pearls or expensive clothes, but with good deeds, appropriate for women who profess to worship God. This is the word of the Lord.
Strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. know what I'll do so that when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses. So he called in each one of his master's debtors. He asked the first, "How much do you owe my master?" 900 gallons of olive oil, he replied. The manager told him, "Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 450. Then he asked the second, "And how much do you owe?" 1,000 bushels of wheat, he replied. He told him, "Take your bill and make it 800. The master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than are the people of the light. I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves, so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Whoever can be trusted with very little can be trusted with much, and whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." For the Gospel of the Lord. Take you on a journey of a few big ideas. Theologically, There are just really three models of seeing the world. There are three critically different theological models. The most common model is called a dualistic model, which is, I think, because language itself is a bit binary and a bit dualistic, we only understand language because we understand that each word is different from another word. Trying to capture the truth of God in language is impossible, but we strive. That dualism model could be described as a two-world model, the world of matter and the world of spirit. So that is, all scientifically observable reality is a veil to God. Pull back the veil, and there stands God. Our God in heaven is behind the veil. We have here before us the chalice and the ciborium veiled. It is a metaphor of dualistic thinking. In the world around us, creation is a veil to God. God stands behind creation. On the altar, the host, the bread and the wine that lies on the corporal, behind the veil, is the source of his spirit. And we are renewed by the spirit that pierces the veil and enters our hearts. That is about the union and communion with God. You should realize, of course, that dualistic thinking doesn't just exist in religion and spirituality. It exists in the sciences. So, for instance, in computing science, it was assumed that computers can only run on binary coding structures for the calculations. But we know now, and from current tests, that the future of computing is in the quantum world. In the quantum world, there's not just ones or zeros in each place. There is superposition, which means that both one and zero occur in the same place at the same time. These computers of the future are estimated to calculate problems thousands and thousands of times faster than the computers we currently have. Those tests already show this. Because I'm at a school, it's important to understand that when we educate future thinkers of the world, we need to ensure that they are capable of critical, creative, and innovative thinking. We need to allow them to understand where the boundary of our thinking currently is, and perhaps to allow them to explore whether that really is a boundary or whether it can be pushed further with deeper understanding. So dualism is that black and white, spirit, matter type of thinking. The next model is a materialistic model. In the materialistic model, there is only one world. The world can be observed and calibrated and measured and seen. There is nothing invisible. No thoughts, no truths beyond. It sees the world as me, others, it. There is nothing else. The temptation in this world is to elevate the me above everything else. And that's what our gospel reading today is about, the wariness of elevating money above God. Slavoj Žižek, a philosopher, said in his book entitled Less Than Nothing, that perhaps there is just a curtain and there is nothing else. So there's nothing behind the veil. There is no God. Perhaps the curtain is it. Perhaps the curtain is endless, but there's just a curtain. The danger of materialistic thinking is in its consequences for our thinking and behavior. In a world of inexplicable pointlessness, nihilism and a journey of superficiality is the only reality. There we can chase money and power and other things that flitter past on the curtain. But what does it matter if you get or don't get a materialistic promise? It is a hedonic treadmill going nowhere. But the model is not incredibly strong. The deep truths of maths, for instance, and their axioms can't exist in a raw materialistic model like that because those truths are invisible. They can be touched by the mind. I wonder too, in a materialistic model, could love really exist? And I feel it can't. It is a world empty of love. So in that dualistic model, doesn't seem to reflect the reality of it, of our truth that there is superposition. It doesn't seem to reflect the reality of the presence of God with us at the same time. The materialistic model doesn't seem to explain the consequences of where we are and what we do. The third and final model is a non-dual model. Non-duality. I'm actually a non-dual theologian. In a non-dual world, there is nothing but God. Nothing but God. Non-duality is raw mysticism. It feels like a madness. Jay Nicholson, in his book Nothing But God, quotes a fellow by the name of Kerouac, who says this: "The mad ones, the ones who are mad to live, mad to talk, mad to be saved, desirous of everything at the same time, the ones who never yawn or say a commonplace things, but burn like fabulous Roman candles, exploding like spiders across the stars. And in the middle, you see the blue center light pop. And everyone, they stop and they stare, their eyes wide open, jaws dropped, and they wonder what has the mad one found. I tell my students I'm the mad one in their community. I'm the one that they think is mad. I'm the one that believes in an invisible God. I'm the one that says that they can experience that. And they give me time to talk to them and to share that experience and to share the truth of the gospel. What has that one man found? That one man or woman has found God." Jean Yves Le Loup, a French theologian, a translator of Greek and Coptic, wrote a book concerning the wisdom of Jesus. He wrestles with a question that Jesus asks, which is, "For you, who am I?" And to know the answer to the, when Jesus asks for you, "Who am I?" is the same as asking the question, "How do you see the world?" And Thomas, good old Thomas, he responds, like with a shrug, like, "How can I capture in words what you're talking about?" And he says eventually, "Master, my mouth could never utter what you are like." Thomas is right. Language utterly fails to capture the truth of God because it is dualistic. How could it with those limits? God is so much more than the word God. God is so tiny to how we understand or should and experience God. Still, despite the restrictions of language, Luke continues to write and explore this insight into perceiving the nature of God when he says this: God is one and three, the Trinity, as lover of the beloved in love. This is transcendent thinking. In a materialistic world, we might see me, other, in it. But Lee Loop says we should see the world as lover of the beloved in love. That's the big line in the sermon, lover of the beloved in love. And this is the invitation of how we are to see the world when we read the gospel. There's a line of scripture, Revelations 22:13. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. There are really just three core Greek letters that actually capture the sentence. Iota, Alpha, Omega. Iota is the smallest Greek letter. Alpha is the beginning of the alphabet, and Omega is the last letter of the alphabet. You can say the word Yahuwah for those three letters. The loop explains that the three core letters and their meaning. This is his reflection on what they mean. I or Iota, because everything comes from him. In fact, it's derived from the notion of I am. It's the being first that God is always. I or Iota, because everything comes from him. Alpha, because everything must return to him, and Omega, because the consummation of all consummations is in him. God is love, and that's the core truth of the gospel. Love everywhere. And to love, what is that? And how can that ever be captured in words? But to love is to discover that we are loved. In every act of love, there is a participation in the love that is given to us and which offers us a participation in its life. This is what the Apostle John means when he says, whoever loves dwells in God and God dwells in him, for God is love. To be able to truly love, even a dog or a flower, is always an act of grace. It's a free gift. Hell is the absence of love, the loss of the power to love. There's an extraordinary line. I once did a presentation in a master's conference on a Christian cosmology, and this sort of material I've been touching now, and I accidentally left a slide on the first half of the sentence. And they were all watching me with bated breath because they didn't know what I was going to say. But behind me were these words. And behind me were the words, God does not exist, and stayed through my entire, most of the bulk of my presentation. And I had to click the next slide. God is existence. God does not exist. God is existence. Non-duality does feel like a madness. So in that vein, in that madness, in that passion, I conclude with the poem I started with called This Is It. This is it, and I am it, and you are it, and so is that, and he is it, and she is it, and it is it, and that is that. And I add that, if these words are true, I am you, and you am I. And there is nothing but God. And that is why we say that we love one another as ourselves, because we truly are. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And I invite you to stand and Let us together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified and was not honored, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scripture. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the world and for the Church.
Let us pray. Lord of all creation, we give you thanks for this day. In your word, you've instructed us not to be anxious, but to present our prayers and supplications to you, knowing if they are according to your will, that you will grant them. Dear Lord, we give you our heart's desires concerning our world, our church, our families, and ourselves. We give thanks for the life and the reign of our wonderful Queen Elizabeth. May her funeral be a great witness to the world and give wisdom and strength to our new King Charles III as he begins his reign. We ask your blessings upon our Prime Minister, Premier, local mayor, and all those in authority. May they work for the common good using resources wisely. As we come to worship today, let's give thanks for the freedom to do this and to remember in our prayers our fellow Christians around the world who don't have this freedom. Bless our church, Lord, for our diocese and our bishop, and we look expectantly for our new shepherd, Dan and Kerry. May we be a blessing to them as they will be to us. We give thanks to all who serve us in this church, including our wardens, parish council, and volunteers. Give them all wisdom as they serve, that they will enhance our church. We give you our family and friends. You love them more than we do. Help us to be faithful in praying for them in all areas of their life, particularly their spiritual. Heavenly Father, we pray for ourselves that we may grow in the knowledge of Christ and be more Christ-like. Bless us in our prayer life and the reading of your word. Help us to remember, Lord, it's not who we are, but whose we are, that we are co-heirs with Christ in the heavenly realms. Accept our prayer, Lord, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
said, "Come to me, all who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Let us say together the prayer of reproach. We do not presume to come to the Lord, trust in our gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
We give
our glory and honour be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever living God. We give you thanks and praise for our Saviour Jesus Christ, who by the power of your love was born of Mary and lived as one of us. By his death at the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, thank you. Gracious God, we thank you that in this sacrament you assure us of your goodness and love. Accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving and help us to grow in love and obedience, that we may serve you in the world and finally be brought to that table where all your saints feast with you forever. Father, the peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen. Can I invite you to stand? Yeah.